listening to Deliverance. Deliverance is a program of faith brought to you from Ireland by the Deliverance Studio team, exploring the deeper questions of life in music and the spoken word.
Welcome to the program. Here's Billy Preston.
I'm giving my life to Christ, for Him to do as He chooses. I'm putting my trust in Him. He's a God that never loses. For Him I sacrifice everything He's not pleased with. On Calvary He paid the price, so I may have eternal life. In my life to Christ, for Him to do as He chooses. I'm putting all my trust in Him. He's a God that never loses. For Him I sacrifice everything He's not pleased with. On Calvary He paid the price, so I may have eternal life. We've got some of our time, so He can lead us and guide us. We must let His light shine. Trust in Him. He's a God that never loses. For Him I sacrifice everything He's not pleased with. On Calvary He paid the price. He paid the price. On Calvary He paid the price.
He paid the price.
So I may have eternal life. Hallelujah. I'm giving my life to Christ, for Him to do as He chooses. I'm putting all my trust in Him. He's a God that never loses. For Him I sacrifice everything He's not pleased with. On Calvary He paid the price, so I may have some of our time, so He can lead us and guide us. We must let His light shine. Let me know that He's precious. Yeah, there'll be no talk or strife. He makes things calm and easy. Yes, He does. On Calvary He paid the price, so we may eternal life. Hallelujah. I'm giving my life to Christ, for Him to do as He chooses. Well, I'm putting all my trust in Him. He's a God that never loses. Yeah. For Him I sacrifice everything He's not pleased with. On Calvary He paid the price.
He paid the price.
On Calvary He paid the price.
He paid the I'm giving my life back to you. And that was the sound of Billy Preston there, playing all the keyboards and doing the vocals as well. And here he was giving us some good advice at the start of this and other deliverance. By the way, if this is your first time with us, I'm Wilbur Fitzgerald, your host for the next half hour, giving you a warm welcome from all the studio team and inviting you to stay with us and enjoy our mix of word and music from the gospel side of the street. And we trust, like many others, you'll become part of the Deliverance family of faith and make a regular date with us at this time of the week. And that's every week throughout the year. Yes, every week. Today we are looking at the power released at Pentecost, that powerful emotive and sometimes controversial subject. But first, the sound of the very wonderful and popular cathedrals. Here they are by way of disc, encouraging us, as James will be doing in a few minutes, to leave the shore and step out a little bit deeper into the waters of faith. Take it away, boys.
Step into the water.
Wait out a little bit deeper.
Let your feet in the light of his
water.
Join angels singing praises to the Lamb of God.
It's time we the people stand up for what is right. It's time we squared our shoulders back and raise our swords to fight. For the Bible is my weapon and the Spirit is my shield. The church needs more of its members to be workers in the field.
Step into the water. Wait out
a little bit deeper.
Wet your feet in the water of his love. Step into the water. Wait out a little bit deeper. Come join angels singing praises to the Lamb of God. To the Lamb of God.
There is victory for the Christian who walks the narrow way. There has been a prize for the soul who does not stray. Oh, I want to live for Jesus and be all that I should be, so that I can rest with him forever, live eternally.
Step into the water, wait out
a little bit deeper.
Wet your feet in the water of his love. Step into the water, wait out a little bit deeper. Come join angels singing praises to the Lamb of God. To the Lamb of God. Step into the water.
The water.
Wait out a little bit deeper. Wet your feet in the water of his love. Step into the water.
The water.
Wait out a little bit deeper. Come join angels singing praises.
Yes, that was the famous Cathedral Quartet there, giving musical expression to the message brought to us now by our very own James Horner, as he invites us to leave the shore behind and step deeper into the purposes of God.
Now, the Bible tells us that God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. This suggests that man also is a spirit. He also has a soul and body. So this is the highest form of worship, to worship God in the spirit. And the Bible also says, worship him in truth. So, spirit and truth go hand in hand together when worshiping God. Anything that is untruthful hinders your worship with God. The Spirit of God monitors everything that is happening in the whole world. And that is why Jesus could tell his disciples that there is not one sparrow that falls to the ground without God's knowledge, because the Spirit of God sees and monitors everything. How much more God is concerned with people who are made in his likeness? When a man or a woman gives themselves to God, the Holy Spirit enters their spirit and they receive the very nature of God. This is called the new birth, hence the term being born again by the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit is a life-giving force in the church. When Christians meet together to worship God collectively, although they meet in bodily form, God only comes to meet them in spirit form, and they also can only worship God in their spirit, which has been transformed by God's Holy Spirit at a point in their lives when they become disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, if we worship God singly or collectively, our worship must be the worship of the Spirit of God. In this spirit worship, all the emotions and the feelings of the human body are tuned to a higher pitch of expression. As the Bible says, we are lifted up into heavenly places. This is where time gives place to eternity. This is where the Almighty meets with his children. And in this contact with God, his children become mighty. This is why it is so important for preachers and leaders of churches to be sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit in their services. They must be willing to allow the Spirit of God to take over any service out of their control, and also to know when the Holy Spirit is handing the service back into their control. Nowhere in the New Testament do you find an order of service. If we read Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12, we find a manifestation of the Spirit of God, not an order of service. On the notice boards outside our churches, we often read the words, order of services. This designates types of services to expect. It also suggests that we are telling God the kind of services our leaders want. And since the members of the church never knew any other method, this is all they expect to happen. No wonder the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost as a rushing, mighty wind, unpredictable. For the Almighty God cannot be restricted to our puny little methods.
No! thy greatness, who can approach thy holy light? For thou art God and God of O blessed Master, author of salvation, I lift my hands and bless your name. Eternal is thy glory, eternal is thy power and
Remember what I said, that no wonder the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost as a rushing mighty wind, unpredictable, for the Almighty God cannot be restricted to our puny little methods. Now, one could quote Paul's instruction in the 1 Corinthians, let all things be done decently and in order. The question must be asked, do you believe in the ministry of the Holy Spirit in your services? If the answer is yes, then the gifts of the Holy Spirit outlined in 1 Corinthians chapters 12 and 14 must be in operation in the church. Or is it that we want the Holy Spirit in our services, but we don't want his gifts? There is much talk about the fruits of the Holy Spirit, but remember, the fruits are produced by the gifts of the Holy Spirit operating in the church. The gifts are outlined as follows. There is the gift of the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the gift of faith, the gifts of healing, the working of miracles, the gifts of prophecy, discernments of spirits, and diverse kinds of tongues, and also interpretation of tongues, which are the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit that should be operating in the church. The first is the gift of the word of wisdom. The gift of a word of wisdom is the spirit of wisdom, where ordinary wisdom fails to deal with some situation. The next gift is the word of knowledge, informing the speaker of information concerning something or situation which he knows nothing about by his normal means, but comes by the Spirit of God. The gift of faith. This is a supernatural faith normally related to the healing of the sick. You see, Jesus healed all the sick because of his faith in his Father God. The next gift is the gifts of healing. Now, these are plural gifts, of course. Many people are exercising these gifts today with outstanding results. God is dispensing his gifts of healing everywhere in many, many churches. Then there is the working of miracles. God is still performing miracles in the world today. Even in places, he is raising the dead. Then there's the gift of prophecy. The gift of prophecy is an expression of edification from God to the church, also cited as the paramount gift of the Holy Spirit in Corinthians. Then there is the discernment of spirits. This gift is the ability to recognize spirits that are not of God. These are spirits that usually relate to evil spirits. There are diverse kinds of tongues. By the unction of the Holy Spirit to speak in tongues, as the disciples did at Pentecost, and also in the churches as recorded in the Bible, in the book of Acts, and in churches thereafter. This gift is used in the church to be interpreted by another gift called the gift of interpretation of tongues, which is also for the edifying of the church. Paul says, "All these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will." The work of the Holy Spirit in this world is the dynamics of the Church of Jesus Christ. Everything that comes to us from God is brought to us through the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, "Our new birth is brought about by the Holy Spirit also." So was the birth of Jesus into this world, for Gabriel told Mary the Virgin, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and that holy thing that is born of you shall be called the Son of God." God is building his kingdom on this earth today, and the Holy Spirit is persuading every sinner to turn to Jesus Christ. Not only does the Holy Spirit lovingly influence the most evil of men not to die without Christ, but he is so concerned about their spiritual welfare that even when evil men reject his pleading, the Holy Spirit begins all over again to turn them to Jesus. You see, the Holy Spirit never gives up because he knows the worth of every human soul. You may think that you are useless and nobody loves you. You look back on your life of complete failure. You have never achieved anything. Everything good has been wasted on you. And now, in your abject despair, you have turned to anything that would blot out the past. Let me tell you something. God really loves you. And he has allowed you to tune into this broadcast to find peace of mind. God's Holy Spirit has been talking to you, and you have not tuned in by chance. There is not a Christian alive who has yet reached the zenith of what the Holy Spirit can accomplish through a human life. I have never met a preacher who believed he could reach his highest pinnacle of an anointed ministry. Only Jesus had ever reached such heights because he allowed the Holy Spirit to lead him. He allowed the Spirit of God to lead him into the wilderness of temptation. But one of the greatest blessings waiting for every believer is the baptism of the Holy Spirit that came in the wind and fire at Pentecost. Peter said, and God told him to say it, "It's for you and for your children, and for those who are afar off, and everyone the Lord has called. You can have it if you will be willing to receive it." And since you have made Jesus, as you have heard, the King of your life, he is more willing to pour his Spirit upon you than you're willing to receive it. And in these last days, God's Spirit has been poured out on this world, and many people are receiving this wonderful baptism of the Holy Spirit. I would like you to put out of your mind all the things that you have heard that would keep you back from going all the way with God, and believe that this is in the Scripture and you can receive it this very hour. What will you do? I want you to stand by your radio sets, lift your hands to God, and as I pray, ask him to baptize you in the Holy Spirit, as it happened on the day of Pentecost, and be earnest, and I believe God will give you what you need. Are you ready? Father, I come to you in Jesus' name, and by your mighty Spirit, I ask you to pour out your Spirit upon those who are reaching out to you now, hungry for your Spirit, hungry for the living Lord in their lives. Oh God, baptize them now. Completely immerse them in your wonderful Spirit, and cause them to lose sight of what is around them altogether and be completely enveloped in the Spirit of God, breathing in the Spirit of God. Just lift your hands now and breathe in God's Spirit. Breathe upon them, Lord, as you did at Pentecost. Breathe your mighty Spirit now. See them, Lord, in that great desire to have more of you. Thank you, Lord, for the precious baptism of the Holy Spirit. We ask you, Lord, that to pour it out on those who are ready to receive right now. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Go on praising the Lord, magnifying the Lord every hour that you can spare. I want to pray with those who have never even come to know Jesus Christ. I want you to give your heart to him. Will you do that this very hour when I'm on this broadcast? Say these words, will you? Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you and I am dissatisfied. I'm a sinner. My past needs to be dealt with. I need someone to cancel out all the wrongs of my life. And only you can do it, Lord. I offer myself to you now, and I ask for forgiveness for every sin I've committed to this moment. Wash me in your precious blood. Make me your child. Father, I ask this in Jesus' name. Give me that new birth from this moment, and I will open my heart to you, become the King of my life. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Amen. And now one of those wonderful gifts of healing. Some of you may need that, so I'm going to pray now. Father, in Jesus' name, you see so many people who are sick and suffering from dread diseases, Lord. I pray that you will stretch forth your mighty hand over this entire nation and touch them now by your mighty power. Heal, Lord, in Jesus' name. Touch them as you did in days gone by. Touch them now because your healing power is just the same this moment. Heal, in the name of Jesus, I ask it. And dear Lord, for those who are bereaved, sad and weary, be with them, Lord, during the long days of sorrow and stress, and those long nights when sleep won't come. Be with them, Lord, touch them, lighten their load, and surround them with your love. I ask it in your wonderful name. Amen. and may God really bless you. Thank you for listening to our broadcast.
This evening's archive edition of Deliverance, presented by Wilbur Fitzgerald, and the address was from the late James Horner. If you would like a copy of this or any of our programs free of charge on CD or tape, or you would like special prayer help or information, then our address to write to is as follows. letters@deliverancebroadcasting.org. That's letters@deliverancebroadcasting.org. And so, on behalf of Wilbur Fitzgerald and the studio team, this is David McClellan saying, till we meet again, goodbye, and God bless you all. Goodbye.